Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Story of Art Without Men by Katy Hessel. Narrated by Katy Hessel.
I'll show you what a woman can do. Artemisia Gentileschi, 1649.
Introduction. In October 2015, I walked into an art fair and realised that, out of the thousands of artworks before me, not a single one was by a woman. This sparked a series of questions. Could I name 20 women artists off the top of my head? 10 pre-1950? Any pre-1850? The answer was no. Had I essentially been looking at the history of art from a male perspective, the answer was yes. At the time, the exclusion of women artists and other underrepresented figures from the history of art was becoming an urgent issue. I had just graduated from my BA in art history and had chosen to study Alice Neal, a great American painter of psychologically charged portraits of people from all walks of life. But Neal was only recognised as a major painter by the art establishment when she was already in her 70s. Studying Neal helped me notice the overwhelming underrepresentation of women artists. They weren't in galleries, they weren't in museums, they weren't in contemporary shows, and they weren't to be found in art history. Why was this? The lack of women recognised as significant artists has been a subject of debate since at least the 1970s, when Linda Nochlin's groundbreaking essay, Why Have There Been No Great Women Artists, was published at the dawn of the second wave feminist movement. Over 40 years later, it didn't seem that enough had changed. When listing the artists who are typically said to define the art historical canon, it is the following names that most often come up: Giotto, Botticelli, Titian, Leonardo, Caravaggio, Rembrandt, David, Delacroix, Manet, Gauguin, Van Gogh, Kandinsky, Pollock, Freud, Hockney, Hearst. I am sure that many of you will have heard of them. But how many of these artists would you recognise? Anguissola, Fontana, Serrani, Peters, Gentileschi, Kaufman, Powers, Lewis, MacDonald McIntosh, Valadon, Hock, Asawa, Krasner, Mendieta, Pindell, Himid. If I hadn't actively studied women artists for the past 7 years, I doubt I would know more than a fraction of these names. Should any of this be surprising? Not according to statistics. A study published in 2019 found that in the collections of 18 major US art museums, 87% of artworks were by men and 85% by white artists. Currently, women artists make up just 1% of London's National Gallery collection. This same museum only staged their first ever major solo exhibition by a historic female artist, Artemisia Gentileschi, in 2020.
And 2023 will mark the first time the Royal Academy of Arts in London has ever hosted a solo exhibition by a woman in their main space, that being Marina Abramović.
Just one woman of colour has individually won the Turner Prize, Lubaina Hameed, in 2017. And it took until 2022 for the first woman of colour to represent the US, Simone Lee, and the UK, Sonia Boyce, at the Venice Biennale, the most prestigious art event in the world. When I conducted a YouGov survey in early 2022 to find out the British public's knowledge of women artists, results showed that 30% could name no more than three. 83% of 18 to 24-year-olds could name not even three, and more than half said they'd never been taught about women artists at school. The night of the art fair, I couldn't sleep. Frustrated and angry about what I'd just witnessed, I typed the words women artists into Instagram. Nothing appeared. And so, at The Great Women Artists, a name that pays homage to Nochlin, was born. I set myself the task of writing daily posts, spotlighting artists ranging from young graduates to old masters, working across every medium, from painting to sculpture, photography to textiles. Adopting an accessible style, my aim was then, as it is now, to appeal to anyone of any art historical level interested in learning the stories of these mostly overshadowed artists, just as I have done on a more expansive scale in a podcast of the same name, which launched in 2019. I do this to break down the stigma around elitism in art. Art can be for anyone, and anyone can be part of this conversation, and to showcase artists so often excluded from the history books and courses I studied. It's not that I believe there to be anything inherently different about work created by artists of any particular gender. It's more that society and its gatekeepers have always prioritized one group in history, and I think it is vital for this to be addressed and challenged. Nearly 7 years later, the result is this book, The Story of Art Without Men. This is not a definitive history. It would be an impossible task. But I am looking to break down the canon I have so often been confronted by in the culture in which I have grown up. The canon of art history is global. However, with the male Western narrative being so unjustly dominant at the expense of others, it is this that I unpack and challenge. The book takes its title from the so-called introductory Bible to art history, E.H. Gombrich's The Story of Art. It's a wonderful book, but for one flaw. His first edition, published in 1950, included zero women artists, and even the 16th edition includes only one. I hope this book will create a new guide to supplement what we already know. Artists pinpoint moments of history through a uniquely expressive medium and allow us to make sense of a time. If we aren't seeing art by a wide range of people, we aren't really seeing society, history, or culture as a whole. And so I hope more books will follow this one, expanding the canon even more. Progress is happening. This is thanks to a collective effort by actively engaged artists, art historians, scholars, and curators around the world of all different ages and backgrounds. It is their work I am greatly indebted to, as without them, it would have been impossible to write this book. I draw here on the extensive research by and my many discussions with spearheading art historians and curators who are endeavouring to change our understanding of art and who makes it. And you can find their works listed in the bibliography at the end of this PDF download that comes with this audiobook. Many of them have uncovered the detail of these artists' lives for the very first time. There is no denying that the increased attention to non-male artists enjoying blockbuster shows or appearing more frequently on museum walls is due to those who now hold top-tier positions in museums. For the first time in history, women have taken the helm of the Tate, the Louvre, and the National Gallery of Art, DC, to name but a few. What does this demonstrate? That the inequalities in galleries and museums are reflective of a larger systemic issue, and so a lot of what we see needs to change. The same can be said for how we place monetary value on genders in society, considering that the highest price fetched at auction by a living woman artist, Jenny Saville's Propped from 1992, was just 12% of the highest price achieved by a male living artist, David Hockney's Portrait of an Artist, Pool with Two Figures, 1972, which topped $90.3 million. I hope this book will show you that the difference in price is not due to inherent quality, but to the value we put on different creators of art. In the past decade, we have seen a huge number of art historical corrections take place. From the numerous survey exhibitions dedicated to women sculptors, painters, abstractionists, or surrealists, such as Fantastic Women, Surreal Worlds from Mary Oppenheim to Frida Kahlo, We Wanted a Revolution, Black Radical Women, 1965 to 1985, or Radical Women, Latin American Art, 1960 to 1985, to the first major solo exhibitions of Pauline Boti, Carmen Herrera, and Hilma af Klint, among others. I hope we will see more, and that my next art fair offers me a different experience to the one back in 2015. So here is my take on the story of art without men. Because while the statistics remain so shocking, it feels important to remove the clamour of men in order to listen carefully to the significance of other artists to our cultural histories. Beginning in the 1500s and ending with those defining the 2020s, I have divided this book into five parts which each focus on significant shifts or moments in mostly Western art history. To avoid artists only being seen as the wife of, the muse of, the model of, or the acquaintance of, I have situated them within their social and political context, in the time in which they lived. While I have grouped artists within established movements, for the purpose of clarity, I am keenly aware that artists are not the products of categories, but rather individuals with varied lives and careers who spearheaded key changes in styles. In the history of art, however, such moments have nearly always been attributed to men, and women's pioneering work has often been overlooked.
So, although I have merely skimmed the surface of many of these artists' multi-layered and for some still evolving oeuvres, which can encompass more mediums, cultures, styles, or time spans than those works and movements discussed here, I hope this book will give you an insight into at least a fraction of the work of non-male artists who have contributed to the story of art.
Part 1. Paving the Way, circa 1500 to circa 1900. Triumphant Women. Being an artist and a woman has never been easy. In the 16th and 17th centuries, leading male artists tackling 5-meter-high marble sculptures and covering entire chapels with frescoes were often termed virtuosi, while women, simply by virtue of their gender, received neither the acclaim nor the opportunities. As time progressed, attitudes did not. It took until the end of the 19th century for women to be allowed to study the nude from life. Linda Nochlin has described this deprivation as though a medical student were denied the opportunity to dissect or even examine the naked human body. Even today, the contribution of women artists tends to be missing from history books and museum collections. It wasn't until 1976 when feminist art historians Nochlin and Anne Sutherland Harris's touring exhibition, Women Artists, 1550 to 1950, opened at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, that women were even acknowledged as having contributed to 400 years of art. This show kick-started the scholarship, still scant, that we have on these pre-20th century artists. Until that point, the role of women in the history of art had been at best a curiosity. During the Victorian age, women, with their smaller, less creative brains, were considered incapable of becoming professional artists and were often restricted to craft or design, genres not considered fine art by the establishment. This perception made it very difficult not only for women to be taken seriously as artists, but for their and their female predecessors' work to be sold. In order to get around this, 19th century art dealers were known to scratch out a female artist's signature and replace it with that of a male contemporary, which explains why so many works by women have only just come to light. No wonder some of them hid self-portraits among their still lifes. Let's right this wrong, because despite their many educational, personal, and professional setbacks, and the lack of historians championing their work, bar some excellent feminist scholars, including Griselda Pollock and Whitney Chadwick, women artists were also driving the changes of their time. They broke boundaries, taught the next generations, and, often rejecting gender conventions and tackling radical subjects, paved the way for the artists of today. To even begin to understand these trailblazers, we must examine the context in which they were working. This will enable us to realize their triumphs as artists, given their lack of social and financial freedoms, resources, and training, all while living in cultures which valued them as less than men. To be taken seriously as an artist in Renaissance Europe, a liberal arts education was required. The study of literature, mathematics, perspective, and, significantly, human anatomy, drawing from art and live models, including nudes. Also key was access to cultural centres such as Rome, Florence, or Venice to study and experience the splendour of Renaissance art and architecture, or ancient classical ruins. All of this was, however, off-limits for women. This lack of access to knowledge exacerbated existing class divisions, which were already particularly acute for women. Whereas boys from lower social classes could be apprenticed in order to learn, most female artists were either the daughters of artists or daughters of wealthy and encouraging noblemen. Alternatively, and only if they were educated, they could join a nunnery where basic activities included copying texts and adorning manuscripts. Essentially, women artists had to have a powerful man, which might include God, looking after their interests. And while having a supportive artist father or husband might mean access to a studio where a female could copy the work of her male peers, she was still extremely restricted in her experience. Things didn't get any easier for hundreds of years. Women were still banned from full inclusion at artist academies in the 19th century.
It was not until the late 1800s that they were able to access a state-funded artistic education and allowed to wander unchaperoned in the streets or visit churches, the latter being another block to the imagination when it came to producing the most popular images of the day, grand, multi-figured historical or biblical scenes with particular attention paid to the human anatomy.
So how did women artists get around this? In the 16th and 17th centuries, they worked mainly in still life and portraiture, genres which were accessible and socially respectable. They painted themselves, sisters and teachers, domestic scenes and objects. It was not long, of course, before these subjects were stereotyped as lowly and unintellectual. But let us not dwell on these hierarchies of subjects imposed in the past. Let us instead celebrate the greatness of such works, since women did come to perfect these genres, monopolizing their markets and even subverting them with proto-feminist twists. Starting with the Renaissance and going on to neoclassicism, spanning Europe, Asia, and America, in mediums ranging from painting and pottery to the beginnings of photography, part one will uncover the triumphant women working across four centuries, ending with those establishing unique methods that were so inventive that they inadvertently influence what will become known as modern art. Chapter 1. Painting herself into the canon, circa 1500 to circa 1700. The Renaissance. Before we meet the radical Italian women in the later 16th and 17th centuries, I would like to single out two artists working prior to this. Caterina de Vigri, a writer, musician, nun, later known as St. Catherine of Bologna, and accomplished painter of manuscripts, and Properzia de Rossi, a sculptor known for her rebellious pursuits. De Rossi was acclaimed for her meticulous and minute carvings in wood, marble, and cherry stones. See Grassi Family Crest, 1510-30. She received commissions for the kind of work no woman had ever done before. For instance, her lively marble relief sculpture, Joseph and Potiphar's Wife, circa 1525-6, which she designed for the facade of Bologna's then most famous church, the Basilica di San Petronio. Both of these women were able to live as practicing artists because they were fortunate enough to be born in Bologna, a place renowned for its progressive attitudes towards women. At the time, Bologna was unique in championing the professions of women. The home of Europe's oldest university, which had supported female students since the 13th century, the city considered women artists as integral to its development. Praised by scholars, written about by biographers, and adored by the locals, they were also supported by patrons of all social classes, from bankers to barbers, creating a varied culture of artistic patronage. By contrast, in Florence and Naples, commissioning was reserved for select noble families. Women were also encouraged to sign their work, as well as to paint self-portraits, for the purposes of being known and, most importantly, remembered. No wonder scholars have recorded a staggering 68 women artists working in the city between the 15th and 18th centuries. These notable exceptions remind us that women have always been perfectly capable of being artists. But while there could have been an abundance of women working at this time, in reality, female artists were an absolute rarity, seen as tokens rather than pioneers. After de Rossi's death, no female sculptor is mentioned in the city's records for 200 years, and little knowledge remains of those working during the Renaissance period. Most of what we know has been passed down by male scholars and through legal documents, rarely from the women themselves. The Renaissance is considered to have begun in the mid-1300s, a good century or two before any detailed record of women artists emerges. Yet we begin this chapter in 1550s Italy, at a time when, as most history books will tell you, the splendours of the High Renaissance were almost over. The year 1550 was when Florentine art historian Giorgio Vasari published The Lives of the Artists, the first text of its kind to explore artists' biographies, featuring some, but very few, women. It is also when the term Renaissance is coined. Translating as rebirth and revival, the Renaissance came about at a time of great economic prosperity and defined a new era of rapid learning and interest in the natural world. In central and northern Italy, artists and scholars rediscovered the ancient past and turned to the study of classical antiquity and literature. With many of the Italian states physically built upon ancient ruins, artists and architects looked to them for theoretical and artistic influence. These included linear perspective, a technique utilizing mathematical principles to create an illusion of depth and space to three-dimensional effect, naturalism to emphasize anatomical accuracy, and secular themes, encouraging humanism and the focus on the individual artists, scholars, and subjects.
Situated on the silk and the spice trade routes and acting as gateways to the consumerist West, the Italian states had amassed enormous riches, which were often spent on artistic patronage.
The artistic capitals were Rome, home to the Catholic Church, the most powerful and wealthy patron, which commissioned works as a means of spreading the divine message of God, and Florence, whose leading banking dynasties commissioned art as a means of demonstrating erudition, opulence, and their ties to the church. However, as noble families from each Italian state increased their riches, competition broke out among patrons, who fought to employ the most acclaimed artists of the day. Greater art on a grander scale fueled technical advancements, and soon each city was attracting a plethora of international travellers. By the end of the 15th century, the Northern Renaissance was born, a cultural revolution outside Italy which saw Renaissance theory diffused across Europe and spurred an abundance of artistic commissions in the Netherlands, England, France, and Spain. All this meant that artists were in great demand, but they were almost always men. However, unfazed by critics who said that the painter's brush was more manly, or by those who referred to them as the passive sex, women fought back. They developed innovative painting techniques and taught younger generations of female artists to eschew the men who would try and stifle their creativity. One such woman was Plautilla Nelli, a Dominican nun who set up an all-female workshop at her convent. The first known Florentine female Renaissance artist, she was one of only four women among hundreds of men praised by Vasari in The Lives of the Artists. Entering a nunnery at the age of 14, Nelli became a self-taught miniaturist painter and then quickly worked her way up to tackling large-scale altarpieces, very rare for a woman of her day. She is now best known for The Last Supper, circa 1560, a recently restored jewel of a painting on canvas and the first known depiction of the biblical tale by a woman. Since 2019, it has hung in the refectory of the Santa Maria Novella in Florence, its first public outing in 450 years. As a woman, Nelli wasn't supposed to take on the challenge of large-scale religious paintings, but she did it anyway. Her richly coloured 7x2-metre portrayal of Jesus and his 12 apostles is full of anatomical accuracy and keen behavioural observations, seen, for instance, in the strained tendons on the apostles' necks and the tenderness of gesture between Jesus and St. John. Clearly invested in capturing naturalism, Nelli portrays St. John as a distinctly feminine figure, with soft features and blush-coloured cheeks, a common way of depicting him, but perhaps also indicating the lack of male models she might have had access to. It is likely Nelli had assistance from her fellow nuns in their all-women workshop. How did Nelli come by the knowledge and skills that enabled her to undertake this work? We know that she rigorously studied and copied drawings by the Renaissance artist Fra Bartolomeo, with Vasari noting that she would have done marvellous things if, as men do, she had been able to study and learn to draw and work after living models. An artist who did manage to secure an artistic education was the northern Italian painter Sofonisba Anguissola, the daughter of a high-ranking Cremonese nobleman who was financially compromised. Determined that his daughters should be well educated, Anguissola's father made the unusual choice to send his two eldest to apprentice with a local painter, perhaps due to the fact he didn't have a son until his seventh child. In this way, Anguissola was able to bypass social norms, earning enormous success and recognition during her lifetime. Holding the most prestigious position of a painter at the Spanish court, she was admired by Michelangelo and praised by Vasari, the latter remarking that her portraits are so lifelike that they lack only speech. Anguissola's quiet and intimate self-portraits display her poised manner and gleaming eyes, often depicting herself playing music or working at the easel with her paints all laid out and her brush at the ready. Anguissola epitomised what a mid-16th century woman with an education could be. Her success was so impactful that she inspired noble families from across Europe to instill in their daughters similar professional ambitions. Capturing women engaged in intellectual pursuits, she famously portrayed her sisters in the midst of a conversational and characterful game of chess. Although mostly confined to portraiture, Anguissola showed great skill in the sophisticated composition of her paintings, from the mountainous, verdant landscapes behind the animated figures in the chess game, 1555, to the intricate religious Madonna and Child scene in self-portrait at an easel, circa 1556. For me, however, her best portrait is self-portrait with Bernardino Campi, 1550. Clever and witty, this work is also groundbreaking in eschewing gender conventions. At first glance, we see Campi, an early teacher of Anguissola, looking over his shoulder to meet our gaze while controlling the young artist's image. But upon closer inspection, we realise that it is not he who is dictating her appearance, but rather she is dictating his. Not only is she taking up nearly twice as much space as her teacher and has him painting the embellishment of her jacket, a task often assigned to an apprentice, but as Pentimento temporarily uncovered in 1996, she originally painted her wrist meeting his, as if guiding his hand across the canvas. Anguissola was capable of great things, and in her old age was clearly just as sharp. When she was in her early 90s, she was painted by the much younger artist Anthony van Dyck. Captivated by her intellect, in 1624, van Dyck portrayed her as both astute and austere, qualities still evident in her piercingly resolute eyes, despite her near blindness. He recalled that she was still very alert and had advised him not to raise the light too high so that the shadows would not accentuate the wrinkles of old age. Although we will never know what she might have produced given the opportunities of her male counterparts, her paintings show a hunger for experimentation and highlight the canny ways she found to subvert the limits put on her talents. Unlike Anguissola, the slightly younger, Bolognese-born Lavinia Fontana did not restrict her production to portraiture. She painted religious and mythological scenes, some on the scale of magnificent altarpieces. Often thought to be the first professional woman painter to run her own studio, Fontana was the daughter of a well-known Bolognese painter and learned the tricks of the trade in his studio, developing her practice by copying his paintings. She adopted a wide-ranging, sophisticated style, with some of her works emulating the characteristics of mannerism, elongated limbs, swirling drapery, and dramatic curvilinear poses. Admired for her portraits, Fontana was especially popular with the Bolognese elite for her exceptional attention to detail and ability to capture sparkling jewels and exuberant patterns. My favourite remains Portrait of Bianca degli Utelli Maselli with six of her children, 1604-5, with each figure kitted out in matching outfits and gleaming lace ruffs. Full of ambition and determined to be remembered this way, Fontana immortalised herself as an educated artist in an array of self-portraits. In Self-Portrait in a Studio, 1579, we meet her at her desk, about to draw antique bronzes and plaster casts, her sumptuous garments telling of her high-ranking clientele. In another, Self-Portrait at the Virginal, with a Servant, 1577, she plays the spinet, with her easel illuminated in the background. But the love knot resting on the instrument reveals a little more. The work is intended as a gift for her future father-in-law, no doubt as a way to show him her talents. Further demonstrating her scholarly knowledge, a Latin inscription reads, "Lavinia, the unmarried daughter of Prospero Fontana, took this, her image, from the mirror, 1577. Aged 25, she married a former pupil of her father, who not only allowed her to keep her maiden name, but raised their 11 children. Running a successful studio, completing a staggering 24 public commissions, she quickly advanced to larger narrative paintings, and her fame spread. By 1604, she had relocated to Rome, then the greatest place for artistic opportunity, where she became a member of the prestigious Accademia di San Luca, and her work was admired by the Pope. Fontana is thought to be one of the first women in Western art to paint female nudes, as seen in her glittering and seductive Venus and Mars, 1595. Across Europe, in Flanders, women were also thriving as artists, although far less is known about them compared to their Italian counterparts. Working slightly earlier than Fontana, Caterina van Hemmersen also began painting in her father's studio and was active during the 1540s and 50s, prolifically producing small portraits, often displaying dark backgrounds, plain clothing, and solemn expressions. Van Hemmersen is credited as the first artist, male or female, to paint a self-portrait at an easel. An inscription on her self-portrait from 1548 reads, "I, Caterina van Hemmersen, have painted myself, 1548, here, age 20. Like her Italian contemporaries, she intended to be remembered as a woman who worked. Still life in the 17th century. With the rise of a new middle class and the spread of the Protestant Reformation in Northern Europe, patrons began to move away from sponsoring religious scenes and towards secular subjects. Still life became increasingly popular as one of the most direct ways patrons could show off their wealth, depicting rarities imported from across the globe, spices, tobacco, vases, rugs and ceramics, and esoteric culinary items, exotic fruits and shellfish, items accessible only to a select few. Still life painting was also considered a suitable genre for upper-class women. It didn't pose a threat to male artists, who no doubt liked to guard great and intellectual subjects, mythological and religious. Nor did it require a knowledge of human anatomy. Moreover, the objects were easily accessible from the home. Paintings of flowers and edible goods, dainties that once lived, also had moral meanings. They represented vanitas, a word derived from the Bible, to remind the viewer of their own mortality, the fragility and temporality of life, the worthlessness of material goods in the eyes of God. With its origins in antiquity, still life was popular in the Renaissance, and at the turn of the 17th century was deemed a respectable art form. Here, again, we find women artists pushing at the staid limits of their genre, demonstrating their high level of skill and looking to assert their identity as artists. This is particularly evident in their hidden self-portraits in still lifes, perhaps in part to avoid the attribution of their work to men. An early adopter of still life was the Flemish-born Clara Peters, who in 2016 was the first woman to be honoured with a major solo exhibition at Madrid's Museo Nacional del Prado. Peters mastered a distinct style of still life, often painting delectable-looking wines, fruits, vegetables, and fish spread out invitingly on a platter, with glowing metal utensils and flowers leaping from their stems. But look closer, and something is revealed in the goblets. Bouncing off the curved edges, small and shiny reflections suddenly catch the viewer's eye, unveiling minuscule self-portraits of the artist herself. My personal favourite is Still Life with a Vase of Flowers, Goblets and Shells from 1612, displaying two highly intricate gilded goblets, a stone vase, shelves, a single tulip, and a porcelain bowl filled with chains against a dark, dusky backdrop. The viewer's eye does not focus on the central goblet, but rather follows the elegant diagonal line that leads us to the one glimmering on the far right, where it reveals, worked into the goblet itself, the most extraordinary collection of self-portraits, around 10 in total. Peters wasn't the only artist excelling at still lifes and miniature reflections in her own work. In Milan, Fede Galizia, thought to have learnt her craft from her miniaturist painter father, began, in childhood, her painstakingly detailed still lifes of cherries, apples, peaches and pears, with her trademark subdued dark backdrops. Although Galizia never dated her work, her earliest still life, which scholars have described as the first dated still life by an Italian artist, is thought to be from 1602. An incredibly accomplished painter, she was internationally renowned by her teens. Galizia, like Peters, was keen on hidden details. Look closely at the expressive portrait of Paolo Morigia, 1592-5, to find a finely worked window reflection sparkling in the pair of glasses lens in the sitter's left hand. The Italian Baroque artist Giovanna Gazzoni painted still lifes full of acute naturalism and vitality. Delicately rendered artichokes with crumpled leaves, plump cherries good enough to eat, leathery lemon skins, detailed observations of wasps. Simple in composition, often with a ceramic bowl at the centre, sometimes with tiny lapdogs, her work draws on objects and fruits from across the globe and blends still life with the precision of scientific drawing. Small, refined and highly collectible, Gazzoni's paintings were so successful that, according to scholars, she sold them for whatever price she wished. Born into a cultured family in the Marche region of Italy, from an early age, Gazzoni learned music, painting, letter writing and calligraphy. Unlike many female artists of her day, she travelled extensively around Italy, receiving her education in Venice and Rome, and later residing in Florence, where records show she met with Artemisia Gentileschi. Unconstrained by one medium or genre, Gazzoni's output ranges from a calligraphy book featuring a series of capital letters adorned with fruits, poetic writings, and letters executed in her exquisite handwriting, to glittering portrait miniatures. One of her best is of the Ethiopian royal prince Zaga Christ. Completed in 1635, this relic-like work, full of meticulous precision and just under 6 centimetres high, is thought to be the earliest depiction of a black sitter in a Western European miniature portrait. The prince, shown wearing European court dress to highlight his royal status, had fled to Europe after the murder of his father, the king of Ethiopia. While in Rome, he was thought to have had an affair with a Franciscan nun. A favourite aspect of this gem of a piece is its back, illustrating the likely friendship between the prince and Gazzoni, where the artist's name is embossed in Amharic script. The Baroque. The Baroque, a period during which the motifs of paintings were often violent and passionate, marked a shift both in the way subjects were executed and in technique. Whereas artists previously favoured the strict representation of form, the Baroque embraced the elaborate and the excessive. Pictures were full of theatrical dynamism and vivid contrasts of light. Beginning at the start of the 17th century, the Baroque's capital was Rome and its greatest patron, the Catholic Church. It demanded bold, emotional, religious scenes to encourage the reading of biblical narratives and help steer people away from Protestantism. Women artists were still rare, although they were less of a curiosity, in part due to the success of their predecessors, and they continued to be held back by societal restrictions and a lack of resources, often resorting to using themselves as models. But while the women of the Renaissance depicted themselves as desirable and educated, I find those associated with the Baroque to be more present in their work, often portraying themselves as biblical heroines, and it's this presence which seems to make them more relatable today. Dark backgrounds infused with stunning light effects, blood-ridden biblical and mythological subject matter, vigorous realism, triumphant women, striking psychological and emotive expression. These are just some elements found in the extraordinary work of Roman native Artemisia Gentileschi, who in her lifetime became an international celebrity. the first woman to be accepted into Florence's prestigious Accademia delle Arti del Disegno. She worked all around Italy and beyond and counted Charles I and the Medici family as patrons. But although she achieved glittering success, her beginnings were nothing short of difficult. The eldest daughter in an artistic family who raised her three brothers following her mother's death when she was 12, Gentileschi grew up grinding pigments in her father Orazio's studio. As a woman, she was banned from wandering freely around the city's monumental buildings and churches or attending the life class, so she rigorously studied and copied the biblical subjects found in her father's grand paintings, subjects she later brilliantly tackled herself. Encouraged by her father, who had given her the distinctively classical name Artemisia, Gentileschi signed and dated her first large-scale painting when she was just 17. Susanna and the Elders, 1610, is a towering work consumed with drama, which demonstrates both her exceptional technical painting skills and her talent for storytelling. Gentileschi recalls the tale of a virtuous young woman, Susanna, who is bathing in her garden when two lecherous men try to seduce her. Filling her viewers with discomfort and anguish, the artist captures the tense moment when Susanna shields her body away from the intruders. Attempting to encroach on her space, the two men almost snatch at her hair while leaning over the panel that should keep them firmly at a distance. This was a common subject in Baroque art, partly for the semi-nude Susanna, but Gentileschi treats it from the viewpoint of the young woman rather than the men. Although I am speculating, this work could also suggest what life might have been like for a woman living in 17th century Italy. In 1611, when working in her father's studio, Gentileschi was raped by Agostino Tassi, an artist friend of her father. Orazio took Tassi to court nearly a year later, primarily because the act had brought dishonor to his family. The traumatic 7-month trial that followed has left in its legacy a 300-page document, now over 400 years old. In it, we can hear the courageous, eloquent, and affirming voice of Artemisia herself. "He then threw me onto the edge of the bed, pushing me with a hand on my breast, and he put a knee between my thighs to prevent me from closing them. Lifting my clothes, he placed a hand with a handkerchief on my mouth to keep me from screaming." Gentileschi was tortured throughout the trial with a sibile, ropes tied around her fingers and tightened, an equivalent to a modern-day lie detector, the most abhorrent persecution for an artist. She was also forced to prove her innocence, uttering the famous words, "È vero, è vero, è vero. It's true, it's true, it's true." Despite a guilty verdict after being protected by the Pope, Tassi avoided punishment, an act that sadly still feels unsurprising today. After the trial ended in 1612, Gentileschi was married off and moved to Florence, where she achieved meteoric recognition. Patrons wanted portraits by her and of her, including portraits of her hand. It was in this period that she produced what is probably her best work, focusing on large-scale, full-figure compositions imbued with psychological intensity. Gentileschi's paintings amplified the roles of heroic female subjects. From Judith to Susanna, Lucretia to Diana, she tackled biblical and mythological stories in ways male painters had never even dared. She altered original narratives as if to enhance the strength of the determined women, as seen in Judith slaying Holofernes, 1612. Painted when she was just 19, the work recounts the Old Testament tale of Holofernes' assassination by Judith and her maidservant. Yet, if we make a comparison with Caravaggio's circa 1600 version, one can't help but notice that in his painting, Judith appears passive and Holofernes mighty. By stark contrast, in Gentileschi's, Judith and her maidservant, who in the original story was keeping watch, take center stage. The two work together to viciously saw a blade through Holofernes' neck, as if they were butchering a piece of meat. Remaining calm, the muscular women gleam in a single light source, lit from below, as they pin down his head, tug at his hair, as seen through Judith's knuckles, and constrain his torso. Blood drips over the ivory sheets, and Holofernes, whose eyes and mouth are just about open, catches his last breaths of life. This work confirmed Gentileschi to be among the greatest artists of her day. Not only did it act as a showpiece for potential Florentine clients, such as the Medici, the women of the court were fans, but it proved that women were capable of tackling such subjects. Powerful and triumphant, Gentileschi went on to immortalize herself in self-portrait as St. Catherine of Alexandria, 1615-17, in the guise of the 4th century saint who was tortured with a wheel of metal spikes and liberated by divinity. Exuding strength, her left hand is actively clenched to the wheel, her right holds a martyr's palm. Gentileschi's stern gaze locks onto ours, commanding in its power. Much of Gentileschi's work deals with women seeking to avenge themselves, yet there is not an instance where they appear as the victim. Although it's tempting to read her own life in these works, we must recognize them as extraordinary paintings in themselves. Gentileschi has become a feminist idol, in part due to her exceptionally strong sense of self-worth. We know from her letters that she was a firm believer in treating and paying women fairly. A frugal businesswoman, in one letter she demands higher fees for multi-figure compositions, and in another, she asserts to a Sicilian collector, Don Antonio Rufo, "You will find the spirit of Caesar in the soul of a woman." But it is only in the past 4 decades that appreciation for Gentileschi has resurfaced. When the Baroque age fell out of fashion in the mid-18th century, her work was quietly forgotten. This was until feminist scholars such as Nocklin and Sutherland Harris, in their influential exhibition Women Artists 1550 to 1950, and Mary Garrard with her groundbreaking monograph on the artist, brought her back to mainstream attention in the 1970s and 80s. Gentileschi is now the subject of books, scholarship, plays, movies, and more. And in 2020, her fame was further reignited with a major exhibition at London's National Gallery, among their fastest ever selling shows, despite the COVID-19 pandemic that raged at the time. Gentileschi wasn't the only woman tackling large-scale works during the Baroque period. Her contemporary, the Bolognese Elisabetta Serrani, although lesser known, was a remarkable painter, draftswoman, and printmaker. Like Gentileschi, she centered her work on heroic female figures. But with her softer brushstrokes and more muted colours, Serrani's scenes appear less overtly dramatic. An exception being Timoclea kills the captain of Alexander the Great, 1659, which features a lively yet brutal killing. Like many female artists of the time, Serrani grew up in an artistic family and learned her practice at her father's studio. Unlike others, the latter was known to oppose her artistic pursuits, but when he was incapacitated with gout, she had to take over, and by her late teens, she was the sole family earner, supporting her parents and 3 siblings. Serrani was prolific and produced more public pictures and altarpieces than her predecessors. She excelled at painting historical scenes, as we can see in her foremost work, Portia Wounding Her Thigh, from 1664. In Serrani's retelling of the story, Portia, wife of Brutus, is seen stabbing her thigh with a stiletto, a tool used in embroidery. Yet she is pictured in a calm and virtuous pose, as if to present a woman's strength and power to overcome. By depicting her historical protagonist in contemporary 17th century dress, Serrani seems not just to draw a likeness to herself, but to foreground the determination and poise of her female Bolognese peers. Known to work in an open studio surrounded by admiring onlookers, perhaps to assert her talent as a female painter, Serrani went on to earn herself hundreds of commissions and was the subject of an extensive biography by the contemporary Bolognese scholar Carlo Cesare Malvasia. He commended her as the prodigy of art, the glory of the female sex, the gem of Italy and the sun of Europe. But at the age of 27, she dropped dead, perhaps poisoned, as scholars once believed. Bologna was in shock. An extravagant funeral was held in her honour at the Basilica of San Domenico, an event complete with a temple of honour, a life-size sculpture of the artist, and an army of mourners. Her legacy, as both a painter and example for women, is still remembered in the city today, with scholars crediting her for the abundance of women who became professional artists in the years after her death. The Dutch Golden Age and Botanical Art. In the 17th century, the Dutch Republic became one of the richest nations in the world. Its thriving economy, supported by colonial exploitation, combined with rapid scientific and artistic developments following independence from Spain in 1581, led to the emergence of a wealthy merchant class who aspired to become patrons of art. The new Protestant ruling class of the Dutch Republic differed in their tastes from the Catholic Italian patrons, and with the development of an independent art market, the demand for commissions meant there were more artistic and educational opportunities. During one of the more liberal periods in art history, the seven United Provinces of the Dutch Republic were not only relatively tolerant of different religious practices, but also more progressive in their attitudes towards women, encouraging their education and allowing them to work in skilled production and trades. This period saw more than 150 female artists, compared to some 3,200 male artists, working with a variety of mediums. Developing psychological intensity and striking light effects similar to those of Italian artists, 17th century Dutch painters rejected the extravagant and reverent splendour of previous Italian movements, favouring smaller-scale, secular conversational scenes, landscapes and townscapes, flower painting and domestic scenes, with some executed in rough, loose brushstrokes, full of dynamism. The city of Haarlem was one of the artistic centres of the age and was also where one of its most prominent painters, Judith Leister, resided. The eighth child of a brewer, as a teenager, Leister briefly lived in Vreeland, near Utrecht. At the time, it was home to followers of Caravaggio, the Utrecht Caravaggisti, who used chiaroscuro for dramatic effect, a technique Leister utilised in her innovative scenes. Dubbed the true leading star in art by a Haarlem historian in 1648, her work could be distinctively identified through her star motif signature. Leister means lodestar or pole star in Dutch. By the mid-1620s, she was already a painting sensation. At the age of 24, she became the youngest member of the Haarlem Painters Guild, one of only two women, and mixed with the most prominent artists of the era. According to legal documents that can still be read today, she once found herself engaged in a dispute with Frans Hals after he stole one of her assistants. Often set against dusky, neutral backdrops, Leister's subjects are brought to life as characters full of effervescent energy. Depicted in casual poses and eccentric dress, their lips parted, they look as if they are about to burst into song. To me, the best aspect of her work is her ability to crystallise the exact essence and aura of the rooms in which they are set. Whether it be a warm, jolly, drunken man basking in afternoon light, as seen in The Merry Drinker, 1629, or a musician in a more intimate proximity, playing his instrument quietly in the night, his face, with its long shadows, lit by a single flame, as seen in The Serenade, 1629. Similarly, Leister's self-portrait from 1630 brims with ease and merriment. Casually and confidently sitting at an easel, one arm resting on a chair and a fine paintbrush in hand, she clasps used brushes and a palette of fresh paint in her other hand, as if we have interrupted her mid-stroke. Elaborately dressed with a matching lace collar and cuffs, Leister delights not only in showing herself in action, but also in demonstrating her ability to paint a range of genres and styles, illustrated in the smaller, full-body study on the easel. In spite of her early successes, she was running a studio complete with apprentices and three male pupils by the age of 30. Her career declined following her marriage to another artist in 1636. She was raising five children and managing her husband's studio, and her few collaborations with him were hardly ever credited. Due to misattribution, it took centuries and scandal, in fact, for her talent to be rediscovered. In 1893, following a court case, it was revealed that the carousing couple, 1630, ascribed to Frans Hals and brought by the Louvre as such, was in fact signed with the initials JL, accompanied by a star. Since then, many more paintings have come to light, more proof of Leister's leading star status. As scientific interest in botany and horticulture grew, Dutch flower paintings achieved popular status, notably in Holland and Flanders, and later in France.
With the ruling classes acquiring goods from across the world, exotic plants were deemed collectible items as another way of displaying one's wealth and connections to trade. Women excelled at flower paintings. A number of Dutch women revolutionized the genre with lifelike, almost breathable paintings that captured the spirit of the tulip mania era, a term used to describe the inflation of tulip prices in the 17th century. Horticulture was already an immensely popular pastime in the Netherlands, as their numerous botanical gardens demonstrate, and the region made flower painting its special subject. Rachel Royce, born in The Hague, stunned art lovers with her highly sophisticated depictions of flora and fauna. Painting until she was well into her 80s, Royce achieved international fame and financial success on a par with male painters of the day, selling her work for up to 750 guilders, nearly twice as much as Rembrandt during his lifetime. Her paintings are still preserved in major museums across the globe. However, she has often been left out of the history books. Impressing her patrons by mixing flowers from different seasons, from peonies and poppies to apple blossom and lilies, Royce had an advantage due to her physician and botanist father. He was a great collector of natural specimens, exotic plants, skulls, minerals, insects, and even went so far as to embalm body parts and whole fetuses. These enabled Royce to bring together plants from all around the world in her work, having examined them at close quarters, and to paint the most idealized, you could say almost divine, bouquets of all time. Often in mid or full bloom, Royce's bouquets burst from their hidden vases while simultaneously straggling into an abyss. Illuminating them from a single light source, Royce not only revealed the depths of her flower's carpels, but painted every angle of the two- or three-tone twisting stems and leaves to expose each vein, wrinkle, and droplet. She even included minuscule insects resting atop plants and scurrying in the petals, as seen in still life with flowers on a marble tabletop, 1716. Obsessed with accuracy and anatomical precision, her technique included pressing butterfly wings into the wet paint to achieve extraordinarily lifelike appearances. Never before had people witnessed such exuberant profusion and pure intricacy of painted flowers as displayed in her works. The mother of 10 children and a member of the Confrere Pictura Artist Society in The Hague, as its first female member, Royce was also a court painter in Dusseldorf. Painting at the height of still life's popularity, some women were also celebrated for their key contributions to scientific advancement, most notably Maria Sibylla Merian, an entomologist, botanist, and naturalist known in both artistic and horticultural circles, whose study of insects is still used by scientists today. Born in Germany and in 1691, settling in Amsterdam, Merian was an insect fanatic. She is now considered as one of the founders of modern-day zoology, in recognition for her significant contribution to the science, with the publication of her volumes of natural illustrations which record the process of metamorphosis of nearly 200 insect species. Merian's break came in 1699, when she, along with her daughter, travelled to the most northeasterly point of South America, where she recorded the existence of native plants and insects previously unknown in Europe. This was one of the first European voyages intended exclusively for the purpose of scientific fieldwork, and the outcome was her dazzling masterpiece, Metamorphosis Insectorum Surinamensium. Published in Latin and Dutch in 1705, it included 60 meticulous illustrations by Merian, accompanied by detailed scientific descriptions. Europeans at the time were so impressed by her research that she received a great deal of praise, with the likes of Goethe consulting her work. But after her death, her contributions went unacknowledged until the 19th century. Merian was only properly recognised in British and German publications in the 1970s and 80s, and, thanks to a republishing of Metamorphoses Insectorum Surinamensium, in 2017, on the 300th anniversary of her death, her name has now come back to the fore. Both Merian and Royce excelled in their field, mastering floral painting to an exceptional scientific and artistic level. But women across the seven provinces and beyond were not limiting themselves to the realm of botanical painting
or even the realm of painting itself. One artist who demonstrated her exceptional ability to translate intricate natural scenes in alternative media was Joanna Curtin. Amsterdam-based and self-taught, Curtin specialised in silhouette paper cutting, intricately carving the outline of images from a single piece of paper set against a contrasting backdrop, which required the same, if not more, meticulous precision as oil painting. Sometimes working on miniature scale, she produced the most delicate narrative scenes, of which a favourite is Virgin and Child with St. John circa 1703. Almost 7 centimetres high, it requires close scrutiny by revealing the most miraculous and mesmeric details. Individual sprawling branches that shoot out like fireworks, ribbons of typescript wrapping around the trompe-l'oeil frame, trick of the eye, divine halos that crown the Madonna and Child, animals that scurry among the trees and leaves. Throughout the 18th century, paper collage, like paper cutting, was a popular medium, especially in Britain among the upper-class women. Pioneering this technique was Mary Delaney. Born to an aristocratic English family where she was taught music, art, languages, and embroidery, Delaney went on to produce nearly 1,000 extraordinarily detailed floral paper collages. But here's the thing, she only started making her paper mosaics, as she called them, at the age of 72, after being utterly enraptured by the affinities shared between a loose geranium petal and a red piece of paper. Immediately inclined to start splicing, Delaney worked ferociously on her decade-long project, Flora Delanica, until her eyesight weakened towards the end of her life. Delaney's inventive collage process was nothing short of groundbreaking, and is thought to have been one of the first examples of collage in the history of Western art. Her radical technique involved her amassing different colour, weights and types of paper, which she spontaneously cut into, with no preparatory studies. She then pasted these cuttings onto a dark, opaque background to create a stark contrast to the luminous floral colours and accentuate the flower's dazzling details, as seen in Sea Daffodil, 1778, with its stringy petals and specks of pollen that twirl and dance in the midst of stillness. Praised for their scientific precision, painter Joseph Reynolds described them as perfection. Delaney's Flora Delanica are so lifelike, it's as though they are billowing freely in the night sky. Just like her contemporaries who advanced the still life or trailblazed new techniques, Delaney pioneered a new representation of botany. In 1772, she wrote, "I have invented a new way of imitating flowers." Chapter 2. Looking to a Heroic Past, circa 1700 to circa 1800. The 18th century. The 18th century was full of advancements, artistically and stylistically, but also for the position of women. Records show that nearly 300 women artists work professionally in Europe as miniaturists, engravers, portraitists, with some reaching new heights of fame, dominating specific markets, earning substantial salaries and commissions from royalty. A few women of this era broke ground with their complex history paintings and sophisticated portraits. They were fast-tracked to some of the most prestigious artist academies of the day, in part thanks to their close ties with high-ranking patrons. And yet, it was the emergence of the very same artist academies, notably the Académie Royale de Peinture et de Sculpture in Paris, established in 1648, and the Royal Academy of Arts in London, established in 1768, that resulted in major setbacks for the recognition of female artists. Although academies had existed since the Renaissance, these two were founded with the purpose of providing artists with essential training, a theoretical education, exhibition opportunities, access to patrons for financial gain, preservation of the artist's work and legacy, and let's not forget, prestige. Unsurprisingly, they were not welcoming to women. Not only did these academies insist on making a distinction between high art, which was promoted exclusively, and craftsmanship, considered low, they also established a hierarchy within painting genres. Large-scale, multi-figured history paintings were at the top, portraiture and still life were at the bottom. Predictably, this worked to the advantage of men, as despite women achieving elite positions at academies, they were still denied access to proper training, for which the study of the nude from life was fundamental.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.